Hello, Restoration Church. My name is Nate Gagney, and I'm the lead pastor here. And I have not preached for the last 4 weeks, so I am so glad to be here together as we start the series Anthems. Some of you are like, I'll hold the applause till after. Time out of the pulpit, time out of the office was really good. I find myself at the end of my vacation drinking only one cup of coffee a day. And man, that you just know things are going good when you're drinking coffee for enjoyment and not for life. So it was a good time together. Just to thank you to Mike, to Andrew, to the location pastors who all preached while I was away. Just so glad for their ministry and for the word that they were able to deliver. And so thankful as we did a series, Quit Church, that you guys didn't take us literally, and you're back here today. It's good. Before we kind of jump into our message, just want to reference one thing. If you've been following the news at all, obviously there's a Category 5 hurricane that was just upgraded this morning that's coming in, going to hit a bunch of the islands, going to hit parts of the United States. I want you to know that when that happens, one of our Kingdom Builders projects, which is our designated giving above our tithe, it goes to global missions projects, local church expansion, and future Christian leaders. One of the projects that we are giving to this year is matching our teenagers' giving to Speed the Light. And our teenagers are giving toward Kingdom Builders already. They've already given over $2,000 this year that will match. We've got a few more months to go. But the Teenagers Speed the Light project is Convoy of Hope. And they're already on the scene with their trucks full of resources and supplies already before the category hits. They'll be the first people providing assistance and aid, and they're always the last to leave. They're before the government, they're there after the government, and so our Kingdom Builders giving is going toward them specifically through our matching of our Speed the Light, our Teenagers Speed the Light giving. So just so you know that our giving's already making a difference on a hurricane that hasn't happened yet. Well, today we start one of our let me tell you one other thing, all right, before I jump in. I got exciting news to share with everybody next week, so you want to make sure you're here for that. And I've got exciting news for the week after that. We've got exciting news coming up in October, so we've planned out all of our exciting news. There's a lot of things to celebrate, and we can't take the 35 minutes of God's word time to talk about it all. So anyway, just so you know, a lot of amazing things we get to share with you coming up. So anyway, we start our annual series, Anthems. I think this is the fourth year that we've been doing this series. So we've been taking new songs that end up on the Billboard Hot 100, and the band's been playing those in our services, and then we've been opening up a song from the Bible and talking about that. Sometimes what what these artists are singing, what everybody in the country seems to be listening to, it's happened at least once where it was an idea that they took from Scripture and they were singing about it. And other times they're talking about an idea that goes completely against God's word, and they're talking about this idea that that the Bible teaches differently about. And sometimes they're talking about an idea that's good, but it's incomplete. As we look at God's word, beginning to see, man, if that's all our life is about, we're gonna miss out on so much. And that's kind of the idea of this song as we get into it and look in this series. So if you've got your Bibles, open up to Psalm chapter 16. And the entire book of Psalms is a book of songs. So these were sung throughout church history for thousands of years. Sometimes we will sing a song on a Sunday morning and we don't realize it has come from a psalm that was in the Bible, and we're still singing them in our church today. There are a few different authors, but one of the most famous ones, authors of Psalms, was David, and he's the author or the artist who wrote this song that we're looking at today. Now, moments ago, the band sang the song, Can't Have You by Shawn Mendes. And in the song, Shawn Mendes is singing about love. He's singing about being infatuated with someone, by someone. And he's saying, like, I can't get anything done because I can't stop thinking about you. You know, I'm a songwriter. I'm supposed to write songs, but all my songs are about you. I'm supposed to be working, but everything. And it's just this constant part of his mind. And that one line in the song that probably stands out and speaks the most is where he says, everything means nothing if I can't have you. That's quite a statement. That's a beautiful, that's a romantic statement. That's something that, that when the song's not popular anymore, you'll remember and use it in your own conversation with the person you love. And may they not remember this. And to use that to gain some points, but it's a beautiful statement. And feelings of romance and feelings of love, I mean, those are, if you've experienced that before, they're good feelings. And for a lot of people, their thought is, really, it's the pinnacle or the peak of feelings, and that is what they live their life for, and that is what they hope for, that's what they dream about. And they're just waiting for that. And it's not enough to have experienced it once, but there's some people who live to just experience that all the time. These emotions, these feelings of infatuation, these feelings of almost floating on air, love. People live for that. And when that feeling goes away, it can cause a lot of catastrophe for people. That's where people, I'm not in love with you anymore. I'm in love with the neighbor. And so I'm moving next door. Don't be surprised when we put up a fence. And these feelings when the feelings are gone, it creates insecurity, it creates stress, it creates a problem. And so some people will do anything to try to feel those feelings or to recreate those feelings. And they are good feelings. We can think that romantic feelings are the highest source of satisfaction in life, to be in love with someone and to love you back. I remember the first real date I went on. I was 16 years old. I got my driver's license that morning and I had a date prepared that night. So we went to the movies. And I overdressed, but it was fine. I remember dropping off her at the house at the end, and it was the 90s, so I walked her to the door, and I'll never forget when she kissed me on the cheek goodbye, and I wasn't prepared for that. And I walked all the way to the car, like, in a daze, like, this is the greatest day of my life. And I went home and I thought about it, and I woke up the next morning and I thought about it, and I woke up probably the next 15 days and thought about it, and those feelings that we have, I mean, they're good feelings, but you know what? They're incomplete feelings. There are feelings that we can feel that are greater than that, that last longer than that, that are more secure than that, and that is something that David is writing about in this song that he wrote somewhere around the time of 500 BC. And he's talking about feelings and relationship, but much deeper than what we experience and what we chase after. So I'm going to read this song to you, Psalm chapter 16. We'll start at verse number 1, and we'll read all the way through it. David writes, and then he sang at one point, "Keep me safe, O God, for I have come to you for refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my master. Every good thing I have comes from you. The godly people in the land are my true heroes. I take pleasure in them. Troubles multiply for those who chase after other gods. I will not take part in their sacrifices of blood or even speak the names of their gods. Lord, you alone are my inheritance, my cup of blessing. You guard all that is mine. The land you have given me is a pleasant land. What a wonderful inheritance. I will bless the Lord who guides me, even at night when my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. My body rests in safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. This is a church song. And you will show me, verse number 11, you will show me the way of everlasting life. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever. It's a beautiful song, which was originally written in Hebrew. It's been translated here into English. But a beautiful song as David is talking about God. Now, this psalm is one of a group of a few songs and a few psalms that have a similar theme. And so there is one pastor who made this comment that I want to put on the screen to share with you about this group of psalms. He said, the dominant feature of each of those psalms, Psalm 16 and the other ones that are paired with it, is a quiet confidence in God as the source of life's highest satisfaction. I mean, let's look at that again. God as the source of life's highest satisfaction. Just think about that for a second, all right? Because we're all coming in here today. From a whole bunch of different places in life, a whole bunch of backgrounds, many different countries are here represented at Restoration Church. And what David is writing is, I mean, that's not something that a lot of people would talk about. Even a lot of people who believe in God and follow Jesus, they wouldn't be able to make that statement confidently for themselves. They would say, God is good, and then someone would yell out, all the time! But they, in their heart of hearts, they don't really, truly live that way or believe that. They believe it as a theological statement, but not as a personal revelation. So by that, I mean not as something they've experienced themselves. They believe ultimately that they'll experience God and all of his goodness in heaven, but they really feel that God's holding out on them now. People struggle with the feelings, maybe that God doesn't really like me, maybe I've made him wrong, maybe there's something that I should be doing differently, and they try to manage their relationship with God like an algorithm, trying all of these just different adjustments and inputs and hoping that something good will come out of it. And because people don't believe God is the ultimate source of satisfaction, that is why this is what leads us to chase adultery, leads us to chase substances, leads us to overwork and neglect our family, leads us to overeat and neglect our bodies, leads us to be stingy people and not generous people, leads us to be judgmental people and not loving people. It's because we don't believe this, that God is the highest source of satisfaction in life. Now, here's a question I want to ask. You don't have to answer. But why is God so good? Why? What is it about him that could cause David to write that, that could cause a church, that could cause a billion, 2 billion believers around the world to raise their hand and say, I agree with that. That's true. I've experienced that. God is the highest source of satisfaction. What is it about him that would allow us to experience him that way? Now, there's some famous reasons. He loves us. God loves you. I think that's really important for you to know and to believe and to accept and to enjoy that God loves you. Not you, the idea of you as a human. Not like sometimes parents, we love the idea of having another kid. But he loves you. The details of you, the characters of you, the flaws of you. He loves you. So that's a big deal, but that's not what we're talking about today. It could be because he sent Jesus to give us forgiveness, and I'm sure we'll talk about that, because that's something very important for us to know, that he loved you so much, he sent Jesus, that you could be forgiven, you could have a relationship with him. But there are these lesser known reasons that show us why God's so good and help point to us the great satisfaction he gives us in our life if we follow him. And that's what David wrote about. He didn't write about the famous ones. He wrote about some of these lesser known ones, and we're going to look at those. If you still have Psalm 16 open, we're going to jump through a few different verses to look at what David wrote and to look at and to help us understand what that means and how that can change our life today. Because if we can understand, oh God, this is goodness that you have for me, but I've never experienced that, and we begin to pray for it, or we ask God for it, or we're able to let go of something that we've been holding on to, knowing that he has something better for us. So let's look at verse number 7. David writes, I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. Here's one of the things that David writes that shows us how God brings true satisfaction in this life, the greatest satisfaction we can experience in this life. And he says that it is his counsel, his advice, God's counsel to us is one of the ways we experience his deep satisfaction in life, is one of the ways we experience his goodness. When we think about God giving us advice, giving us direction, giving us counsel, I asked some people this week, I said, what's so good about his counsel? And it's hard to answer that in a real way that's not like a church answer. What is so good about his counsel? Well, he sees the beginning and the end. So we know that his counsel is perfect. So he doesn't tell us, take a left turn here and then say, oh, sorry, it's a dead end street. Do a U-turn, go back the other way. And he's trying to navigate us through life like we're trying to navigate ourselves through Boston. God knows the beginning and the end. He's got the entire thing mapped out for us. And so his direction, his counsel is always perfect. And that is different. If you're in a romantic relationship, you can enjoy and benefit from the counsel of your boyfriend or girlfriend or of your spouse because, your girlfriend can tell you how to dress. Hey, your clothes don't match. Did you know you're colorblind? No, apparently I did. Hey, let me help you. Let me pick out your clothes. And there's benefit for that. You know, when you ask your husband what type of hairstyle do you like, and they tell you, and then you make your hairstyle like that. Like there's counsel that you give each other, but the counsel we give the people we love, it's biased. It's biased toward our own benefit, and sometimes in unhealthy and toxic relationships, and even subtly in a healthy relationship. Our counsel is really just a disguised manipulation. And it's our attempt. I'm going to tell you to do things that benefit me, tell you to do things that I enjoy, and we don't always consider what is best for the other person. So the husband who still is demanding his wife gets a perm is not considering the fact that perms are mostly out of style. And if you're under the age of 30, they're definitely out of style. And so if you're telling your 25-year-old wife, like, I just love perms, you need to get a perm, you're not considering her work environment or any. And so it's a selfish benefit through that. If you're picking out the wardrobe for the person you love, that's a little bit so they won't get embarrassed. It's a lot more so you won't get embarrassed. But God's counsel to us, though it's always for his glory, it's simultaneously always for our benefit. He doesn't tell us to do something to use us or abuse us or manipulate us. It's always for his glory, and that's important to know. Your relationships, your romantic relationships, your giving, your job, your career, your garden, your building projects, your family, it's all for his glory. But also, so different in that it's also for our benefit. That every step and every bit of direction that it gives us, even when we don't understand it, it's moving us closer to him. It's moving us in places that our benefit, we can't even really understand. Second thing David writes about here is in verse number 8. And he says, I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. And David's singing about and praising God for his stability. Now, this is obviously a lot different than sometimes relationships can be. There's the chaos of divorce and destruction it causes in hearts and lives. And it can take years and it can take sometimes decades for people to recover from that. It's very, whether you're a kid whose parents were divorced, you're an adult who's gone through it, it's a difficult thing to walk through. And what you thought would be forever sometimes can even end suddenly through sickness or death that was unexpected. Now here you are, a single parent, here you are, a widow, and you've lost income, you've lost ability, and now it's just this chaos of now poverty, risk, hunger that you weren't prepared for, and even a great godly relationship can end suddenly without warning. This can cause fear of abandonment, this can cause fear of loss, it can lead to all kinds of dysfunctions in our life. As we now battle with anxiety we've never battled with before, as we put up walls in other relationships, protecting ourselves from never feeling or being that need again, to even experiencing jealousy in other people. Instability and trying to walk through life in instability and in unstable relationships, even the best relationship, is not stable. Even in a godly relationship where you're both pursuing Jesus, it's not stable because at any point, if you don't continue working on that relationship, there could become a division. At any point in there, one person could begin to hide sin from you and from God. And I'm not trying to add insecurity to or instability to your life, but it is hard work to continue that. It's like being in a canoe with four boys who are age 10 and under, all right? There's a lot of rocking, a lot of mom screaming. This could tip at any moment. Now, there's one thing in here that is written in another part. So one of the guys named Moses spoke this scripture. This is not a song, but he says this in Deuteronomy chapter 31. He says, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. And God, we can experience life's highest source of satisfaction confidently, knowing he's not going to pull the rug out from underneath us. He's not going to decide to not, to go on vacation for 4 weeks. He's not going to decide to abandon us. He's covenanted himself to us, which is what we celebrated during communion today. He is the stable relationship. Next thing David writes about is in verse number 9. He says, no wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. My body rests in safety. And David is singing about and praising God for his security. Relationships are insecure. God is secure. Relationships are insecure. God is secure. This is something that when we meet him, when we follow him, when we know him, that is absolutely transforming for us. One of the lines in Shawn Mendes' song was, it doesn't matter because I'm so consumed staying up all night reading texts from you. And you know that feeling when someone doesn't text you back? It's feelings of insecurity, feelings of they hate me, and it's this awkwardness. This doesn't really happen in marriage, all right, but I suppose it could. Maybe if they were on a trip for work and they didn't text you good night, they didn't text you good morning. All of a sudden, what's going on? Have they died? Have they left me? Have they fallen back into old patterns and lifestyles? And so it's insecure. Now there's the joy that comes from those conversations, reading those over and over again. Look at all the emojis they sent me and just like, you know, look, they put two people hugging. That will be us one day. I read this week, a guy, these are adults. So these are adults in their 30s. They went on a date together. And the guy was a gentleman. He paid for the meal, and then she didn't text him back. And this went viral. He sent her an invoice for the meal. After she didn't text him back for 3 weeks, he sent her the invoice like, hey, you owe me because you didn't even bother to text me back and tell me you wouldn't go out again. So it went viral. He did eventually to submit it to collections agency. So I haven't followed up on what happened with that, but that's pretty interesting. It's pretty expensive ghosting there. Wow. And you know, but the difference, there's a difference that when you meet God and he changes your life, people stay up all night reading the text from him, the scriptures. I want to hear what you say. I want to read what you're like. The greatest example of this that I've ever experienced in my life was my own dad, who didn't grow up in Christianity and end up giving his life to Jesus while at work. And he was a welder. They worked in a fabrication shop, and one of his coworkers led him to Jesus. My dad was 22 years old, blue collar guy, just graduated high school with no aspirations of education or school ever again. Just, I'm a welder, that's what I do, and I drink beer on the weekends, and that's what I do. And when he got saved, when he gave his life to Jesus as a young 20 year old, he read through the entire Bible in the next 2 weeks, cover to cover. I want to know everything God has to say about me. The following 2 weeks after that, he read through the entire Bible again. So within 1 month of following Jesus, he read through the entire Bible twice. This is a little bit about the security of God. I just want to hear everything you have to say to me. I want to read it over and over again. This is something that is great about God that we don't really understand. And the last thing in here that David writes about is in verse number 11, you will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence. I want to invite the band everywhere to come up and join me. The presence of God. Now, we could do an entire series of this. Maybe we will next year. Maybe we'll wait for the year after that, but we could do an entire series of this. So to talk about here in the next 35 seconds is a lot to cover. But the presence of God is something that you can experience for yourself. And so that's a shocking moment in someone's life where, wait a minute, I believed in God, but I just felt him. That was frightening. That was scary. And sometimes, but that was great. I've felt calmness, stillness, and peace like I've never felt in my life. We had one person communicate recently. They had left the church years ago, but we had bumped back into them. They said, you know why I stopped going to your church? I'm like, it's not the preaching. Oh, you know, so what else could it be? I'm not sure. And maybe the air conditioner, that could be the issue. And she said, every time I went to the services, I cried. From when it started to when it ended, I cried. I just couldn't handle crying anymore. I was like, you're here this morning. This is not a funeral atmosphere. So what causes someone in this atmosphere with so many smiles and so much joy and celebration, so many good jokes, what's causing them to cry through an entire service? It's the presence of God. They couldn't identify what it was. They didn't want to admit that God was real, but yet he's working in their life. And so their decision was, I'm going to take off and ignore this. And I want to encourage you, when you come in and you experience something, you were singing the song, you're like, man, this is different. There's something happening. This is different. I wasn't expecting this when I came into church this morning. When you're driving in the car and you just feel a calmness, a stillness, a peace you've never felt before. That's God showing you how real he is. And he's showing you how active he can be and he wants to be in your life. In those words again, he says, you will show me the way of life, grant me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever. David, who wrote this song, he's talking about the satisfaction, God as the highest source of satisfaction in their life. A lot different than Shawn Mendes. He's talking about the satisfaction of this relationship. A lot different than the things in your life that you've gone to for satisfaction. That if we go to God, we can experience what we won't experience anywhere else. And David and his own family, we have a great example of this. As David wrote about this, he made mistakes in his life, but he always knew that God was his source of satisfaction. But his son Solomon didn't quite understand that. And Solomon, he wrote some of his own songs that are in the Bible, and he wrote about his own experience in the Bible, but he tried in so many different ways to experience satisfaction out of life. He tried to find satisfaction in his work, but found it empty. He built temples and mansions and building projects, but just said once it was built, I mean, that was it. It was just a building. He sought fulfillment through wisdom, but then he said, you know, I'm gonna learn everything I can. And he traveled and learned and built huge libraries, and then said, you know, it's just vain. It's just knowledge that when I die, it dies too. He built a beautiful mansion. He landscaped beautiful, breathtaking views, but he found no pleasure in it. No matter where your view is, there's days where it's just a view, or days it's covered with clouds. He tried laughter and alcohol and parties, but he found this to be madness, that it just didn't bring what he had hoped it would. He had sexual pleasures that few people have ever experienced. He had 700 wives. He had 300 concubines, but they couldn't satisfy him. Even that got boring. He had unimaginable wealth, so much wealth. He's one of those people who can't, there's just too much money to spend, but yet it couldn't buy him happiness. And he wrote about this in the book of Ecclesiastes, which you can read for yourself when you go home if you want. And he finally concludes this in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse number 13. He says, that's the whole story. It's everything I try to do. It's all vanity. He says, now here's my final conclusion. Fear God and obey his commands, for this is everyone's duty. He's saying, listen, I've tried everything. There's no satisfaction in it. You want satisfaction in life? Man, just follow God. And he wasn't able to learn from his father's example. It could have saved him a lot. Or maybe he just was one of those people who was too stubborn to say, I'm not taking his word for it. I'm gonna find out for myself. And he chased everything he could and ended up at the same conclusion his dad did. There was a Christian author named C.S. Lewis, and he wrote this last statement here before we pray. It says, we're half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. What that's meaning is we're just playing with our mud pie in our slum, in our life. Just doing the thing, I'm happy with this. And someone's offering us the opportunity and the experience of a lifetime. And we're like, island getaway, all inclusive, all free, everything paid. I'm fine here. You know, playing with our mud pie. This is the comparison of our life. If you're not chasing God, you're hanging out, you're playing with mud pies, and God's offering you something much greater. If you feel comfortable, you close your eyes. What's going to happen right now is I'm going to pray. You're fully welcome to stare at me during this time. If you're worried about some of the ushers going through your backpack or your purse or something. All I want to do is pray for you. that you'll experience the presence of God like I talked about. And if you're someone in here who's never made the decision to follow God, to follow Jesus, that you do that right now. You just, in your seat, say, all right, God, I'm giving it to you. I'm giving my life. I've tried everything else. It hasn't led me anywhere. I'm giving my life to you. I'm going to follow you right now. That simple statement, asking God to forgive you for the things that you've done, telling him that you're going to follow him, changes your entire life. Jesus, when he talked about it, he said, it's so dramatic, it's like you've been born again. You're starting a whole brand new life now. Everything's new now that you know Jesus. So I'm going to pray for you, and maybe you're someone who's a Christian, and you know what? You've forgotten how good God is. You've been chasing other stuff. Or maybe you've just been busy, or maybe you've been in sin. To talk to God about that. There's another part in the Bible where God's encouraging us, return to your first love. You've met him. You've experienced him. You've experienced his goodness. But because of heartache, because of problems, maybe you've forgotten, because maybe you started chasing other things and you realize, I can't believe I've allowed myself to get here. The good thing about God is he'll let you come back. So your prayer is simply, forgive me, God. Forgive me for not trusting you. Forgive me for chasing these other things. And allow him to love you. Allow him to work in your life. Jesus, I pray for every person in our services today. I pray for every person who's watching this online. I pray, God, that the moment their heart begins to shift towards you, the moment the words begin to come out of their mouth as they ask you for help, as they ask you for salvation, as they ask you for forgiveness, they will feel your presence, your physical presence that is unlike anything that can be experienced in this world. I pray that not only will they recognize and experience the benefit and satisfaction of your love and of your forgiveness, of your peace, but they'll enjoy and experience the satisfaction and great feelings of your counsel, of your stability, of your security, and of your presence. May we, as people following you, experience your pleasures and your satisfaction and your goodness forever, we pray. Amen.